Good morning and welcome to this morning's webinar with the Cybersecurity Accelerator for Baker Donelson. My name is Justin Daniels and I'm joined this morning by Steve Bachman. Say hello, Steve.
How you doing, everybody, and welcome. Looking forward to spending the next couple of minutes with you all and sharing some thoughts, insights, and getting some great questions, Justin.
So before we begin, we wanted to do a few housekeeping items that relate to the webinar. One is you will get a copy of the slides in an email after the meeting. The speaker bios are available on the screen. If you would like to submit questions, please do so, and we can read those, and we will do so at the end of the presentation. There will also be a survey for you to fill out at the end to let Steve and I know if it was thumbs up, thumbs down, or thumbs sideways. And last but not least, wanted to spend a couple minutes to make the audience aware of our big event that's coming up on September 27th, which is called CyberCon, which is a conference that brings together business leader, government officials, and academia domestically and internationally to talk about cutting-edge cybersecurity issues. The unique feature of our conference is we will have up to 12 cybersecurity companies who have been selected through an application process to have 5-minute pitches to our audience, who will include CIOs and CISOs from companies such as NCR, as well as Norfolk Southern Railway, as well as Home Depot and other large Fortune 500 companies around town. The application process for that particular aspect of the conference is due on August 27th, and selections will be made soon after that deadline. The Baker Donelson Cybersecurity Accelerator, our sole mission is to accelerate the development of domestic and international cybersecurity companies, and we are currently open for business. This webinar is part of our educational process for the accelerator and the value that we offer, which consists of mentorship with people such as Steve, who you'll hear more from today. Also, opportunities to hire interns who from Kennesaw State and Georgia Tech that can work for the company for credit for college from the cyber programs. Third, access to the resource of our law firms. And then fourth and most importantly, potential networking opportunities with prospective CIOs and CISOs of companies who may have an interest in buying your product. And you can check out the accelerator at www.cybersecurityaccelerator.us, and you can also check out CyberCon at www.cybercon.us. And so with that, we're going to get started with our webinar today on selling your cybersecurity product to large companies. So Steve, why don't we get started? We're going to make this a pretty informal conversation to share with you the experience that Steve and I have had working with cybersecurity companies who are trying to sell their products to large corporate buyers of those products and services. Steve, time for you to talk.
Thank you, Justin. First, everybody, welcome. Want to be informal, and please feel free to queue up whatever questions you have as they come across, and we'll get to them, we promise, at the end of the session. I think a good place to start, Justin, is the classic challenge of the whole cybersecurity marketplace. Let's not spend time talking about how big it is, how big the problem is. I think everybody understands it from the newspapers and the press, from those of us who are building solutions for it, and for the organizations that potentially are affected by it. And what I thought I'd do is kind of really share what I think is perhaps the biggest challenge, and the challenge as it relates to selling products to larger organizations. And I think the biggest problem is, for the last 10 or 15, maybe even 20 years now, the CISO or whoever that person in charge before the world had CISOs goes to the executive committee, the chairman of the board, the CEO, the management team, and says, remember I told you last year I was secure and everything's okay? Well, I need more. And I think the biggest challenge is we're always being asked to add another layer of security on top of what is already in place. Because in most places in large organizations, there's lots and lots and lots of dollars, tens, hundreds, millions, tens of millions of dollars of information security infrastructure in place already. Is how do we go in there and how do we pitch, I need more, or how do we help consult and advise the CISO how we need more? That to me is the biggest challenge, and it never ends, because you know you're going to come back next year and probably do the same thing. I think the other key piece is not only is the challenge hard, because we're really selling some complex products and complex solutions, I think the problem is that selling to the big corporations just isn't easy. And I think if we want to cover anything in the next 15 or 20 minutes, Justin, is kind of talking about what are some of the challenges of working with organizations of size versus working with a small to medium-sized business where you could sit with the owner, operator, single shareholder, and senior exec of the company. So, you know, Justin, you know, I know you spent a lot of time in working and advising your clients about working with large organizations from an end-to-end approach, and talk a little about, you know, the sales cycle.
So, as the slide suggests, the sales cycle is long, and so what companies, emerging growth cybersecurity companies, need to appreciate is you really have to have multiple irons in the fire. You're just not going to have a great meeting with a CIO or a CISO who says, great, we love your product. It is going to be a long process because you have to appreciate the other stakeholders who are involved in the sales cycle that you have to align, which we will talk about. But to think that it might be just a 1 or a 6 week process, it just isn't. And so you need to factor that into your business plan, factor that into if you're looking for investment and they want to see traction. Those are all significant things that you need to factor into how you're assessing the growth of your company. And then how do you want to go about it? You know, a lot of clients that I work with are looking for a distribution chain of maybe one type of company. Maybe it is a large consulting firm who then can white label their software to all of their customers as opposed to going, you know, customer by customer down the street. So there are various different options to consider, and obviously the strengths and weaknesses in each approach, and also tailored to the strengths and weaknesses of your organization, your sales force, and your culture.
Yeah, I think the other thing we all have to remember, and I put my sales executive hat on, is when we're asking our team where are we on the sales cycle, especially with large organizations, a sales cycle isn't over when the CISO or the champion of the product says, I want to buy it. We all need to remember that there are budget processes and cycles, there are purchasing processes and cycles, and we'll talk a little about that, and then there are some legal and contractual processes and cycles that we got to make sure we add to the entire sales cycle so you can start having alignment from when you think you're going to close business and when you're actually being you're able to start with the implementation, and more importantly, when you can finish it and start getting paid.
So, Steve, let's talk a little bit about, from your perspective, working with a lot of companies and yourself, when you've been head of sales, and what exactly is the proposition that you're trying to persuade a large corporation to purchase your product as opposed to a competitor or something else?
Yeah. And I think, Justin, I think that's one of the key questions is you know, what are you trying to communicate? Let me start with what I don't think one wants to communicate with. I see a lot of younger companies especially leading with features as opposed to leading with value. And let me kind of explain that in a little bit of a story. You know, let's take a hypothetical company in the that has a security encryption product for data and encryption and other things like that. One could imagine leading and talking to the organization they're trying to sell to say, I have a data encryption product that encrypts data in the cloud, off the cloud, on the cloud, in your email. It does all these kinds of things. I don't think that resonates as much as a message that says, we have a solution that protects your data, that data can be anywhere, in the cloud or on your premises, as well as we can protect communications. I think it's about advantages and benefits and how your product and solution fits in, especially as we said, there's already a whole bunch of security products out there. Where does it fit in, and what's your unique value proposition as opposed to just what it does? At some point in time, you're going to have to review what it does, but if you want to get that audience, you really got to start by asking the question of, what is it going to do for me if I'm the CISO or I'm the chief security technology lead in an organization? I'm looking for solutions. I'm not looking for technology. And I think that's very key, and I think we see too much of it. I'm sure when you talk to your clients as well, Justin, that sometimes is a challenge as well.
Yes, I think the one thing that I see is when they go through the sales process and you get through to that CIO and CISO, a lot of times what I see is my client who's selling the product doesn't listen to what the actual needs are of the customer. They go in and say, hey, our product protects the cloud, does this, and really the customer may say, well, I'm looking for an enterprise solution. So what I see a lot of times are a disconnect between going in and, in essence, throwing up all over the customer about what your product does, but not really taking the time, either prior to the meeting or picking up on the cues during the sales meeting with the customer, to figure out what it is they want, what they need, and trying to solve their problem, because you may be solving a great problem, but if it's not their problem, you're not going to get down that funneled sales path to getting that sale. And I see that one time and time again.
The other challenge for everybody as we're working with these larger organizations is, I guess best way to sort of, there are multiple buyers you need to satisfy. And let me give you an example of what it's not. I was sitting having a conversation the other day with a VP of sales for a company I'm on the board of that sells to small to medium-sized enterprises, and they talk about the sales process of their last success of going in, sitting with the owner of the business, and effectively were able to make a pitch and got a decision from that one person. They needed to talk to a couple of other people to get some buy-in, but it was a quick cycle. And it was a clear single point of decision. If the owner of the business said, we want it, the organization was going to get it. That doesn't happen in larger organizations. Just because a CISO even says we have to have it, there is a whole bunch of other buy-in you need to get across the organization in order to make that solution, you know, brought in, the organization trained, and it to get deployed. And I think very often we who sell information security solutions focuses so much on the CISO, we forget that there are other, I guess the best way to call them, stakeholders in part of these large corporate decisions.
So, Steve, I would emphasize that, because if you talk to the CISO, you also have to consider that the company's going to have a budgeting process, so the CFO may be involved if it's a large purchasing decision, as well as the IT department, who actually has to implement and install the product on the server or however it gets installed. And then, of course, the legal department's going to probably weigh in, because if you're touching certain connectedness to the server or whatnot, they may have legal concerns, as well as negotiating a contract that formalizes the actual relationship that you have with the potential client. So Steve and I have just identified for you, not only you have to get the CISO on board, but now the IT people are going to probably be involved, as well as the CFO, because this could be a significant budget item, and then as well as the legal department. So there, we've just identified four different stakeholders who you may not have considered when you initiated the process to work with the larger customer to hopefully buy and implement your product.
Great points, Justin. The other piece I think we want to, you know, just touch on very, very quickly is a point of there is competition out there. We all know our product is the best. Our product is the only one that can do the solution. We need to have that arrogance and edge when we're going in. But in addition to positioning the value, the messaging, understanding the organization as you're going through the selling product process, I think it's critical that you also try to get a sense of who the competition is. And the competition, remember, can be doing nothing at all, because that is a barrier to getting a sale. So I, without spending a lot of time here, I just strongly encourage everybody to remember they are competition always. Larger organizations sometimes require multiple competition if it's an institution that requires a bidding process. For example, a university.
The government,
thank you. And you need to think about positioning your solution as a unique solution, not only for the needs of the customer or prospective customer, but also as unique positioning of how you differentiate yourself from the competition.
Okay.
Justin, why don't you talk a little about, you know, the structures and the complexities of the organization a little bit, and, you know, what might be common, but what might not be, because I think we want to categorize every Fortune 1000 company or every global 1000 company the same way, and I wish it was, but it really isn't. They all are not the same.
No, I mean, part of the value of social media these days and LinkedIn is the opportunity to get feedback from other people who may or may not be in your industry of, you know, what's it like to deal with a Georgia Pacific, or what's it like to deal with a NCR or an Equifax in terms of their buying culture and whatnot, because that helps you ferret out, you know, expected obstacles you might face or how you need to work with that organization, or understanding culturally, are they all about the bottom line? Are they all about a particular type of product, or is there a certain initiative that the CIO or the CISO may be starting that, you know, you need to be aware of? So understanding the culture of the different companies, I think the rule is a lot of time people go into sales and say, okay, I've got my presentation, one size fits all. And the better approach, even though it takes more work, is to really understand the different customers, even if they are a Fortune 500 company. The cultures are different, and tailoring your presentation and what your product does to the needs of what they have, and I can't emphasize this enough, is when you're in that meeting, really listening and talking less to what your customers' cues are, what is important to them, and really trying to identify that, because a lot of us make the mistake of going in there and we have to talk. And really what we ought to be doing is listening to what the customer is identifying as their needs, what some of their obstacles might be, who are some of their hidden stakeholders, because you may not always know who the real stakeholders are or decision makers when you go into that meeting. And so that, unfortunately, when you put all that ingredients into a bowl, that causes the decision structure to be a little bit more complicated and require more attentiveness and understanding that it will be a sales cycle, and it is incredibly important for a growth stage cyber company to have multiple irons in the fire, because they're all going to be at different points in the decision-making process for that customer, and it can be a frustrating, seemingly contradictory process, but if you want this type of customer who can make it very easy to get to another customer, because you can say, hey, I have a contract with NCR or someone, it makes that next contract much easier to get. But like everything in life, that first contract is the toughest.
I think the only other thing I'd like to add, Justin, because I think you did a real good job of covering all the bases there, was a lot of times the decision structure is also tied to the driver of the decision. Is this an internal decision that says we just need to solve a void in our security infrastructure? Is it regulatory? Is it, you know, if you're selling a product to a college or a university, there are a whole bunch of other issues related to protecting of the students' information. Is it financial? So I think what you'll find is you'll probably be able to categorize the process and the decision structure depending on what some of the business drivers are for the problem, the underlying problem that's driving the potential purchase decision for the solution that you're presenting. And I think it's very important to be aware of that, because it does make a real difference. I'll share a story of a group I'm doing some work in that has some IoT cloud-based data acquisition systems. They've been doing tremendously from a growth perspective. They had an opportunity to sell to a university, and all of a sudden the security requirement, while it looked very interesting, some of the security requirements changed dramatically, and we've actually decided to walk away for the moment addressing that market to go back and focus on the market that we're much more comfortable with, just because we don't have an adequate amount of time, or maybe say it differently, we could use our time better being more focused on some of the organizations with the kinds of structures that we fit in much better.
So I think the other thing we wanted to touch on is the purchasing process being complex. And what we mean by that is you need to go through getting a champion in the organization. Maybe it's the CIO, maybe it's their right-hand person. Then you're going to go through potentially a budgeting process of figuring out how much something is going to cost. Then, of course, if you get to the point where people are willing to buy, now you get to deal likely with the legal department and a contract. And that process is the whole process in and of itself, because then you get into what type of contractual indemnities. Are they going to require certain types of insurances? And that whole process can take anywhere from 30 to 45 days. And the thing to keep very aware of is an in-house legal department, that's a sunk cost for a corporation. So if they want to be tough on provisions or whatnot, they don't care that you have to pay your attorney. They consider that to be your problem. And what I've found time and time again is dealing with corporations, there is a large corporations, there is a hidden cost in terms of what you might expect in your legal expense, because it'll be up to your attorney to really identify a lot of these issues, because a lot of corporations at the lower level of their associate general counsels will just say no because that's what they're taught to say. And then you have to really probe them, and they're count on the fact that many companies don't want to take the time, the effort, and the expense to do that, and that can delay the process and increase the cost. But there may be certain types of indemnities that you have to have so that if something goes wrong, it isn't like a extinction level event for your company because you owe several million dollars because you didn't get a cap on your indemnity. And so the thought here, and we're not here to talk about contractual provisions, but from a sales process perspective, that the legal process to get a contract in place can take up a significant amount of time, effort, and cost. And the other thing I want to overlay is Steve alluded to dealing with universities or governments. That is yet a whole nother issue, because they a lot of times have RFP processes that require you to look at their contract, make a process, and even if you're the winning bid, you may then have to negotiate the contract. And with the government, they work on government time, and so their level of responsiveness may even be delayed, and so the sales process to actually get them on board to have a contract and then implement it can even extend beyond what you would normally expect dealing with a large corporation. So you need to consider those things when you are trying to find the mix of your customers, be it a large corporation, a big consulting firm, a university, or a government. The sales cycles there are a little bit different, and particularly with the university and the government, my experience is those seem to take significantly longer than if it's just a large corporation, and those are not short either. Again, that is why it's so important to have multiple irons in the fire with multiple prospective customers and have the capacity to be following up with them, because a lot of times people go on vacation, you fall into a place where they're not following up, and you're the one who has to be proactive with your sales team to be following up on what their needs might be, their objectives, their obstacles, objections, so that you can move that process forward, because from an emerging growth company standpoint, it is key for you to get those sales in place, and it's really up to you to shepherd that process forward. Don't wait for that phone to ring.
Yeah. Just a couple of other just quick thoughts related to a couple of deals I've been involved with over the last couple of the years. One is, if there's an opportunity before you get to a contract to put together what I'll call a memorandum of understanding or a framework of, we're going to do this, these are the products, these are the services, they're going to need to do that, meaning they, the prospective customer, is going to need to do it. I think you'll find that is can be quite helpful, because sometimes you go through the selling process with the CISO, you negotiate price, it hits purchasing, and then they want to start again because that's their job. Additionally, I'll give you an example. I was working with a venture-funded company. We were doing a large licensing deal for security, information security technology, to a 500 plus million dollar, actually they may be $1 billion plus company. We ended up getting through the purchasing cycle, it went to hit legal, and instead of presenting them a contract or an agreement, we asked them if they had an agreement for us to review, because it was more cost effective and it was easier to get through, because for us, time was of the essence. We wanted to get the deal closed before our board meeting and our next round of venture funding. So sometimes timing can be as important as a lot of other things. And in some cases, it may be easier if you can start with an agreement that has already been through their business cycle, and our attorneys did an absolutely brilliant job of clawing back some of the things we couldn't live with, and the reps and warranties and the terms and conditions. But I think it's very important to really understand that path getting through the organization when you're dealing with large enterprises, as much as it is the decision process on your actual technology. There's two sales processes within one organization, and they tend to run completely differently. Because remember, purchasing is also, you know, buying 100 million Coca-Colas, sticking the Coca-Cola machines in their organizations around the world. And sometimes we just get caught there.
Oh.
Okay. So Justin, just give everybody a recap on what's going on with some of the exciting things and the programs here in Atlanta with Baker Donelson in supporting the cybersecurity community, especially the startup community, and then we got a couple of questions here that I'm going to queue up, and if there are any more, feel free to type away, folks.
So just to recap, on September 27th of 2016, we'll be having CyberCon 2016 at Georgia Tech. That conference, again, brings together the business leaders, the academia, and government officials. We're actually going to have two of the senior-level government officials from the U.S. Department of Homeland Security who will be joining us, especially Dr. Phyllis Schneck, who's the head cybersecurity official for DHS, to do a fireside chat. Also wanted to remind you that if you have a company that wishes to apply for the one of the 12 coveted pitch spots, those applications are due on August 27th. And then if you're aware of a international or domestic cybersecurity company who really wants to accelerate their development, the Baker Donelson Cybersecurity Accelerator is available and provides you an opportunity to work with great mentors such as Steve, have access to my law firm and resources such as myself, to really help develop your go-to-market strategy and figure out how best to scale your company so that you can successfully reach that next level with multiple customers and scaling, because Atlanta is known as a real robust cybersecurity ecosystem, and this is part of our effort to build that awareness and whatnot. And the last two slides of our presentation talk a little bit about both. And you can always reach out to me personally or Steve, or go to our websites, which are www.cybercon.us and www.cybersecurityaccelerator.us. And Steve's contact information and my contact information are also part of the slides.
Yeah. And everybody, please feel free to Phone's nice. The easiest way to get to both of us is probably drop us an email, but I promise you we will get through it, and we will respond to it much better than trying to dig through 35 voice messages.
And so, okay.
So let me start. Great first question. Talk about a memorandum of understanding. So before you want to go enter into a contract, it's always nice. Well, go back a step. Remember, when you're entering into a contract, you've probably been through the CISO and the buying decision in the technology team. You've now been passed on to purchasing, who registers you for a vendor and does all those things you need to do in order for an organization to buy from you and, more importantly, to pay you. And then sometimes you're passed off to their legal department, and you're told, put a contract together. And what I found from the business side is it's helpful to be passed on through purchasing and legal with a piece of paper that says, this is what we're going to do. This is the price that has been agreed to have been paid for. And these are the terms and conditions under which we're going to work. Not all the legal terms and conditions, but the business terms and conditions. So what I like to use is what's called a memorandum of understanding. An MOU says, and Justin, you can add to this, says, I, Steve Bachman, and my cybersecurity company are going to do this. We're going to do A, B, and C. Provide you our product, provide you this number of seats, provide you this amount of service, provide you this amount of costs on a subscription basis. This is what you're going to do. You're going to provide, you, the customer, are going to provide us access to the infrastructure, allow us to install it with your team, make people available for training and administrators, and then both together, we're going to do these kinds of things, whatever they are. If you can get that agreed and initialed, it's very much going to help you move through the process. We're not going to worry about what are the legal protections my company needs, or the CISO's not going to because they don't have the authority to do so. But what we want to do is we want to set the business terms in place that gives guidance for our corporate counsel and the corporation we're trying to sell corporate counsel the guidance around which to build something. Justin?
So I guess what I would add to that was Steve is suggesting an MOU is another way of saying a letter of intent. Yeah. And all you're basically identifying, as Steve suggests, are the important terms. And what I would add to what Steve said is you may say, okay, we're getting paid on a subscription basis. There may be milestones that you have to hit. You put those in there. From a company perspective, you may want to have what the term is. You get paid within 30, yeah. 60, or 90 days, because that's always a hidden gotcha, because yeah. companies love to pay you 60 or 90 days later, which can create cash flow issues. You don't have what are the indemnities, what are the insurance pieces, but you put this together so you have a basic level understanding on the significant business terms, and that way purchasing and legal have something to start with instead of putting in what they typically do, which sets back the process. Steve is trying to circumvent any kind of delay by saying, hey, this is something we agree to. These are the most important points, and that helps focus purchasing and legal on what the terms are rather than leaving to themselves to their own devices, which will be reflexively what is maximal benefit for the company, not you, and then you're starting all over again from scratch as opposed to having what we consider to be like rules of the road that you and the CISO have developed that inform what the next steps. It saves you time, ends up saving you money.
Yeah. And more importantly, you got to remember, Justin, that they understand how to buy a million cases of Coke.
Yes.
There's a good chance that what you're selling them and the company is buying, they don't understand.
Yes.
You know, very, very, very big piece. Hang on a second. We've got a couple more questions here coming up. Let me jump in with another one first. I want to kind of a general question. What does a startup need to do?
Mm-hmm.
In order to sell to a big organization, and we all know it's always a challenge because everybody, you know, has heard the story of you never get fired by. In the old days, it was buying from IBM. In the newer days,
Cisco.
It was from Cisco. In the newer days now, if you buy from Apple and Facebook, you never get fired. But that still doesn't mean if you're out there with a unique product and a unique solution, providing unique value, that organizations are willing to take risks. Part of the challenges I think one needs to look at is it's back to selling the value and selling what sometimes may be pitched as a stopgap measure. But I know a lot of earlier stage information security companies that convinced organizations to buy things because there was nothing else. And once it's in and if it works and if it's not broken, the good news is larger organizations don't want to go around and fix it. So even if there's threat that the competition is going to have it down the road, if you can solve a unique problem today, there really is real opportunity for earlier stage companies to get buy-in and adoption of some of the earlier technologies. And I think we see them, in fact, you see them a lot just from the perspective of a lot of the larger corporations are investing in some of the accelerator programs, just like Baker Donelson is, to help facilitate and identify some earlier stage solutions. Because if you got a regulatory problem you got to solve today, someone doesn't want to know that you can't wait for a solution.
And I guess I would add that is one of the major reasons we set up the accelerator, was to be an intersection between Fortune 500 companies who need innovation and smaller companies who are great at innovation. Because what we may do with our program is set up discrete opportunities where under an NDA, a large corporation may come in and talk about a discrete problem that they're having and then identify for you the problem that they need to solve. And that's part of what an accelerator with a reputable law firm has to offer, because they know that our law firm clearly understands sensitive data and NDAs. And, you know, that's part of what occurs with our accelerator. So I think the next question is, how do you work with a company that's not in Atlanta? So the answer to that question, short of coming to Atlanta, is our particular law firm has offices that we have about close to 20 offices all over the southeastern part of the United States. So the resources, for example, if you are in Baton Rouge or if you're in New Orleans, you have access to our Atlanta resources. You may or may not work with one of our attorneys locally, but the opportunity to work with the accelerator is probably through one of our offices. But if that's a specific question with more details, I would probably urge you to either call me or email me, and I'd be happy to have a more detailed conversation about that.
Yeah. And just like we're having this webinar online, Justin and I have worked with organizations all over the place. Thank goodness for go-to meetings, Skype, email, secure email, and all those other great tools. Most of that beats getting on an airplane. It's much more cost effective and efficient. And I'm doing work with people East Coast, West Coast, and right now over in Europe. I've done a lot of work with people down under, Australia, New Zealand, in my career. And I know Justin's doing work with people around the world as well. So geography should not matter.
So the next question there is.
Okay, bear with me. Next question is, how do you sell a cutting-edge research technology? It may be a solve of a problem that the company has not yet identified as a problem, but may be there.
Steve Jobs approach. Yeah, they don't know what they want until you show it to them.
Yeah, I got to say, I've been more successful in crossing that barrier in smaller organizations. I've always found it's tougher in large organizations to sell them things that are not identified. And take a step back. You know, even the CISO or the VP of IT or anybody on the executive committee probably discussed with the senior leadership their top 10 priorities, which was probably scaled down because of time and budget, right, Justin, to maybe two or three or four key initiatives. It's very difficult if something hasn't been identified through those initiatives, to walk into the CEO and say, hey, boss, you know my key things I needed to do? I really was wrong on those. I want to do something else. So there's an optics issue. There's a momentum issue for the team. And the other issue is the educational process is very, very, very long. So I think one can sell research without a problem, but I think it's going to be a long, long-term sale, that the sales cycle doesn't start until the educational cycle
has been completed.
And I'm not so sure if you need to match a initiative, whether it's a legislative initiative, a compliance initiative, an initiative in the news, and try to wrap around a problem you're solving, because solving one they don't know they need, they're going to solve the ones they need first. At least that's been my experience.
So the next, I think, last question we have is, does your accelerator work with other incubators? And I think the answer to that is we do collaborate with other incubators, but the real differentiating factor of what we're doing is we only focus in cyber. There's one other accelerator in town that focuses in cyber, but it's a three-month program, where ours is a 6 to 24-month program, because we really focus on customer development. But yes, if there are questions about what other accelerators do we collaborate with or aware of, we certainly are. It's just a matter of what your particular needs are, and does one organization over another help meet those needs and your expectations?
Last two questions. Let me start with the second to last one. Is you know, Justin mentioned, and this follow-up to a comment Justin made, Justin mentioned that, you know, sometimes a path into an organization is through a partner. If you think about what you gain from a partner, whether it's a reseller, it's a consulting partner, an integrator, is you gain presence, you gain expertise, you may gain a local presence, you may gain relationships, you may gain trust. So one needs to look at alternative ways to bring your solutions to the customer. And I don't think, I think I would say, I don't believe that there's a better way or a worse way to do it. I think you need to look at this on your unique situation and what you're trying to do. I typically worked with organizations, and my organizations had a combination of direct selling and indirect selling, and the cost of that indirect selling is margin, because your partner is going to need to make money, or they're going to go sell, because they got to pay their costs and feed their salespeople and their team. But you know, that's something that may be is a whole nother webinar, perhaps in the future. But you know, I think you need to be open to what your go-to-market strategy is, and I know Justin mentioned that earlier.
So one last question is, yes, there will be a recording available. I believe it'll be possibly on our accelerator website. And I guess the last question we have is for Steve, which is just, you know, how do you view, you know, the Baker Donelson accelerator? What is it different about, you know, a law firm actually having an accelerator? That's pretty unusual in the marketplace. So if you could just talk a little bit about why you're drawn to it, what value you think it adds to the community.
Well first of all, you know, thanks for inviting me here, Justin. So I think there's a couple of things I see. One is, and let me go back. Besides being a participant as a mentor, I've actually recommended a number of organizations and companies I'm involved with or have been involved with to consider the accelerator. I think the key aspect of it I like is, what it does is it's a vehicle and a platform to bring the right level buyers together with potential deliverers of technology where they might not necessarily have access to those people. So it's a business accelerator from that sense, from a sales pipeline. It's an exposure accelerator, which, again, is a business accelerator. And it's also, in my mind, a credibility accelerator, because our nominating committee is very broad, but more importantly, the selection committee is very deep and very experienced. And I think if you get through the selection committee into the into our group here, because we have an absolutely fabulous group, you know, it just gives you a heck of a lot of credibility. In my mind, I don't want to say it's a no-brainer, but it's tremendous value that's getting provided, and there's just nothing like it here in Atlanta. And I'm not sure if I'm seeing anything similar to it any place on the East Coast or any place else.
Well, anyway, I think at this point, since there appear to be no other questions, we want to take this moment to thank Steve and thank our audience for attending today. And if you want to catch us, please come to CyberCon on September 27th. And the accelerator is open for business if you'd like to learn more information or put in an application. Again, it's www.cybersecurityaccelerator.us. So thank you very much for your time and have a great rest of your week.
Thank you, everybody. Have a good day.
What are we doing?